can email out the presentation that's going to have links to that. It's a really great series, and I happened to just find it when I was looking. I wanted to find a brief video by Jerry because I just love everything he has to say. So this is the one I found, and it happens to be part of a website called Five Things. So it's kind of like TED Talks, but they pull in experts. They invite experts to talk about something of interest to them, and they boil it down to their 5 points. So I'll share that link so you can watch it again and get more information. Okay. How to market your art? Just the basics. This is one of them. Start with one of my favorite quotes by Albert Einstein. Imagination is more important than knowledge. So I really believe, like Jerry, that art is the greatest thing that humans can do, can create, right, with our hands and minds. And it's imagination that is the creativity. Whether you're a painter or a scientist, it's imagination, it's the creativity part that allows us to invent new things. So I think that's a great quote. So again, this is all in your handouts as well, but just emphasizing that the most important thing that we all share is the ability to create. The five essentials that I want to talk about are, one, to own the title as artist. I think a lot of you do, and I think I'm sure some of you are like, how do you make art? Well, you make art, so you're an artist. And you know, the sooner you just like accept it and acknowledge it, the better things will be, and the better you'll be able to communicate with the rest of the world, right? The second thing you want to focus on is creating your portfolio. Whether you're entering an exhibition or not, really think about your work. Organize. What is finished? What do you like? What do you want to share? Okay, like gather it together and then get good photography. I can't emphasize enough how super important this is. We all spend so much time, thought, energy in creating what we create, and then we have bad photography. Who can understand it? If the photo is blurry, if it's too dark, if it's not, if it's out of focus, to someone who's never seen your work, it's just going to look like a blurry photo. Because this is so much that's going to be lost. So whether you learn to do it yourself, which people can do, you know, the phones are really great these days. If you can afford to hire a photographer, that's even better. But get good photography and curate your work. Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. Third is researching goals. Again, we're going to go to 5 points. And if you talk to other curators or people in the art world, they'll tell you this too. You're starting out. There are many, many galleries and museums out there in the world, and in LA it's exploding. There's more and more all the time. How do you know where to start? Identify 5 places. It doesn't even have to be LA, but your favorite galleries and museums. Identify them, and then do a little exercise and write down why you like them. What is it about? What is it about that place that you like? Whatever it is, there's no wrong answer, but again, it's about doing the exercise of self-understanding. You know, think of it like journaling or creating a vision board. Like this whole process is really, it's about self-knowledge. Like why do you do what you do and why do you like what you like? And then we're gonna connect it together. To create your marketing. Same things. So the next point is to stay informed. again, you know, I mean, we're already here with the volunteers group. Debbie's announcement was great, but yes, I encourage people to branch out, try, go explore new places. How many people here have been to the Torrance Art Museum? Okay, that's about half. Torrance Art Museum is an incredible contemporary art museum. It's like a hidden gem in Los Angeles and everywhere. And it's a growing establishment, growing in the sense of conceptually and its connections. So I highly recommend. It's free. Go check it out. You're not going to love everything that's there. sometimes the shows are extremely conceptual, which makes it an important place in the sense of the larger art world. What they're doing is very contemporary. It's very cutting edge. And just mark my word, it's not going to be long before you're going to start seeing articles and pieces about that museum on a global level. So seek out things. There's plenty that's local. You don't have to like go downtown, although I encourage people to do that. But we have Angels Gate Center. We have this art center. We have Angels Gate, which is in San Pedro, just 15 minutes away. There's First Thursdays in San Pedro with artist studios and galleries open up. There, let's see, the Loft has artist studios and galleries. I mean, there's Manhattan Beach Art Center has been up and coming. They're doing more and more as well. So, yeah, there's a lot you can do in a 30-minute for circumference, right? And then the last thing, which is our events and goals, are your resume and statement. And then a third would be a bio. But definitely resume and statement. So does everybody know what the difference between an artist statement and an artist bio is?
Not really.
The three are, okay, so you know what a resume is, it's your that's the most like official, right? The most nuts and bolts, like where'd you go to school? Where have you exhibited? What groups are you affiliated with? But it's the list of associations. An artist bio is a paragraph or two about who you are as a human being. Where were you born? What kind of lineage did you come from? Were your parents artists? Were they not? Was it hard for you to become an artist? Was it all in the family? Just as a, more like the human story. And then an artist statement is about the artist talking about the work, about your work, right? So we'll go into that. Does anyone have any questions about any of those five? Yeah.
Your portfolio, is that a digital portfolio that you have, or do you make a portfolio like a booklet with your pictures, or how do you?
These days it's mostly digital.
Yeah.
Digital. Yeah. I mean, you can definitely have a, if you have work that you can put into a physical portfolio, that's convenient for you. I mean, the real thing is always better,
yeah.
Right? But digital is the most common.
And you do it other than at Call for Artists, because that's the only place I have my portfolio right now.
Okay, yeah, so we're gonna talk about Instagram being great tool for that.
Okay.
And it's great because you don't have to set up a website. Like, that can be daunting too, you know, to set up your own website. Instagram makes it just so super easy. And it's actually becoming very common that even businesses and organizations, although they may have a website, they actually use Instagram more as far as like their marketing tool, getting messaging out for their events and stuff, because it's such a globally accepted and widely used tool. So I love this cartoon that Debbie found, Calvin and Hobbes. I always tend to explain, so my work is utterly incomprehensible and therefore full of deep significance. Again, this is about you understanding yourself and defining your work and who you are as an artist.
So,
the points. Keep it clear and concise. Talk about your creative process and themes. Talk about what are your inspirations. Were you inspired by an artist when you were growing up or last week when you saw something? Was it something in your life that happened that inspired you? Whatever it is, be personal. Think about what was it like, why did I start doing this? The more authentic and personal you can be, the clearer the message is going to be conveyed to a person you know. That was really cool. But okay, let's move on. So there's some examples. We have a few examples of artist statements. Yayoi-sama. Everyone's familiar with Yayoi. Now I'm going to just read like the first one or two sentences of each of these. Obviously, she is actually the most successful female artist. She's the richest female artist ever in history. Yeah, amazing, right? I'm not sure what her net worth is, but pretty fantastic. Like, it's done well over hundreds of millions. She might be worth $1 billion, right? I don't know. It's amazing, and she bloomed very late. Like, we didn't really start hearing about her until like the last 10, 15 years. She's 90.
Lived late because men were keeping her down.
What's that?
She lived late because men were not allowing her in their circle.
Right. So I think, I was wondering, I know there's some members that are male, and I'm glad it's an all-female group today. But that's another thing about the art world. This is an incredible time because finally women are getting their time. Institutions, galleries, museums are trying to rebalance history, and all of them are really trying to elevate and promote women artists and some reparations for all the decades where women were not recognized. Right? Great thing. But so her first sentence is, "I am a painter who is inspired by beauty and mystery of the natural world. My paintings are a celebration of color, form, and texture, and a meditation on the relationship between light, shadow, and atmosphere." It's a mouthful, but it's so clear, right? So it's a language, but does that make sense? The clarity of our statement. Let's try another one. Georgia O'Keeffe. The notion that you can make an artist overnight, that there is nothing but genius and a dash of temperament in artistic success, is fallacy. Great artists don't just happen any more than writers or singers or other creators. They have to be trained and in the art school of experience. Mark Rothko, his first sentence actually is like the opposite of what Yayoi says. I am not interested in relationships of color or form or anything else. I'm interested in only expressing basic human emotions, tragedy, ecstasy, doom, and so on. And the fact that lots of people break down and cry when confronted with my picture shows that I communicate those basic human emotions. The people who read before my pictures
or having the same religion I had when I painted them. Really super powerful. But again, it's like speaking very authentically, directly about what art means to each of them and conveying that in words. Okay, so let's do this little exercise. So take the back of one of your handouts. Does everybody have a pen? So we're just going to do the three things. One, how do you define your art? So what kind of artist would you call yourself? Okay. Two, write a sentence or more about your creative process and feelings. And then three, share something about what inspires you. Everybody love that? Okay, now it's time to share. Anyone want to share what you've written? No? Okay, I will go first. I just recently wrote a statement. I have a show, I'm in a group show that's opening on Saturday. It's a kinetic art group show in downtown LA. So it actually has no painting involved, but I have a large piece that's got a stone carving element and branches and feathers. But I'll read you the statement I wrote for this. Yeah.
Well, come on. So
I just can't. I just can't enlarge it so that I can read it.
Lenny?
So number one is abstract and landscape painter. Number two, I start by connecting inwardly in meditation or journaling to enhance my connection to the beauty and wonder of nature. I then write the word love on the canvas and I'm guided from that. And then I inspire, number three, I'm inspired by bringing beauty and inspiration to the world.
What was the last part?
I'm inspired by bringing beauty and inspiration to the world.
Right. Oh, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Thanks for sharing that. I love that you write the word love for the start of everything.
I don't even know when I started doing that. Maybe when I just started landscape painting like 12, 15 years ago, and it just started. So
cool. Yeah. That's very cool. Anyone else? We're up.
I am so not good at this. I'm not a good writer. And I have to admit that every time I'm supposed to write something like this, it sounds kind of BS to me.
Oh,
you know
yeah.
What I mean, it's like sometimes it's just too much.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. And you know, I mean, you don't want to sound like boring, but at the same time, sometimes maybe you're writing something, I guess I don't feel confident, so it sounds like kind of.
Sharon? No? Joanne? Okay.
I have a statement that I usually use because it's written for the general public. But the reason I'm looking at talking about why I actually make art from fundamentally, as I like containment of boxes and then go in the box, in other words, the defined space, defined rules, which is what I like about realism, because people will say it's not real. You know, no, that's not real. And, you know, so there's a limit. Like, so, but then I like to go to the edge of it and push it and get as far away from that, but still hang on to realism. And so that's one of the reasons why I use realism. The other thing in my paintings, which most people don't detect, you know, they see, I don't know, something like us, but, you know, you see an object that you recognize, and that's the first layer. But what I'm really using things like things that are not paintable, like pain, agitation, fear, things like that. There's some there that can be the thing of the painting, but it's not like sticking in your face. And so underneath all of this pretty stuff, because it's realism, and sometimes there's, you know, plants and things like this, and there's actually a message in there that's hidden behind all of this stuff, and that's the thing of the painting. So it's and I'm fascinated with illusion and magic, and there's something, there are hidden things in my painting. It's probably so private, I don't, you know, so that's why I like to do the show, to see if anybody can see these things in my paintings, so I can actually talk to the viewer after they look at my work. That's what I like to do now, because to me that's like the fourth step of, you know, I make the thing, and now I need one more thing to happen to the work, and that's for somebody else to do it. And, you know, start processing themselves. And so, because it's both like illusion and magic, and some of my favorite stories that I've heard in art school was about Chinese guy, painter, gets put in prison, but he gets to keep his paintbrush. So he's sitting in prison, and he paints a door on the wall, obviously not more than, you know, the brush, opens the door, and leaves. And this was some weird Chinese story about, you know, something they threw in prison regardless of what it was. But anyway, I was going, okay, they're listening to that story and they're sort of believing it. The guy actually came to the door and walked out of the room. So illusion can be very powerful, and I like it, it's magic, and it's been used in painting for a long time. Because the early work was, you know, they gave you paints in the face of God. So now we don't have God's face to paint anymore, but we're talking about ourselves, and so in my paintings, they are fundamentally about me. Now, I have to consolidate this mess of gathering into some sort of state, which I so far have not been able to, but I'll work on it.
Yeah, that's a lot of content.
Yeah.
It's fascinating, and it's very detailed.
Yeah.
Have you written one before? Do you have one written?
I have one that I use most of the time because it's proper for the general public. It's a very personal and it explains some of what I'm doing.
Right.
And so that's what I usually use, and I tailor it for the situation.
Right, exactly. So it's good to have a master statement that's just talks about the general work that you do, and then if there's specific pieces that you want to talk about, you talk about that. But then you cater or modify to the situation. So like the one I just wrote for this upcoming show is one that I had to write completely over because it wasn't about painting anymore. It's about something that I haven't done in a long time. So had to redo it, right? Or do another version. But again, like that's something that just continues to grow. So once you write it, tuck it away in a folder somewhere and reference it. And then the next time you have a couple to reference.
So thank you.
Thank you all for sharing.
Julie?
Thank you. question, your opinion on, once you have all this together and you're going to create a website, I already have a website where I sell my items, but everything I do then, I have to hustle myself to sell, and I sell derivative items of it. But if you want to approach galleries as well, some people say that galleries hate seeing your website with prices on them because it interferes with their ability to sell it. What do you think? Have prices on your website with your original paintings, or?
Okay, so, if you're at this level and you want to approach galleries, so there's what's called market value, market price. So whatever you price your work on your website should be the same price that the gallery should be able to sell it at.
That's,
so,
that's what I've done.
Okay.
But then, if it doesn't go in that direction, the price is high because it's 50% higher than what? So should I just carry on like that?
I think it's okay. Like, what's the range of price points?
$5,000 is what I'm selling for large,
okay.
Charging for large paintings.
Okay, so that's totally reasonable. Yeah, that's what I mean. Just tell the galleries that this that you priced your work at market value.
Okay, so maybe that's what I should write on the website is market value, and then that's a hint to people that they come to me. Less than that.
Maybe the
camera's
gonna like that.
What's that?
Yeah, it's a tricky thing. Yeah. And there are collectors that try to go directly to artists to try to bypass the gallery and the markups.
Yeah.
So it's
like
a disservice
that.
To the galleries. I mean, you know, all I can say is it's in your own private moral code what you decide to do with that. If you want to work with an artist, if you want to work with galleries, you want to respect that relationship and try as much as possible not to sell your work for less than what the gallery would sell it for. I mean, in the end, you would win because you take all the profit. There would be no cut if you sell it directly, right? Does that make sense?
Yes.
But if a collector sees your work in a gallery and then a month or two later is like, hey, I want to come visit your studio. I really like that work. And then can I get it for 50% of the price?
But you have an agreement then with the gallery.
Right. It happens. All scenarios happen, and as an artist, you have to decide, you know, how you want to carry that moral code.
I just had a question, on a different subject, but how do you deal with paying taxes if you are an artist that sells artwork on your own? Do you have a business account, or do you?
There's certain brackets. Well, so if you're just starting out.
Will you repeat her question?
Pardon?
Will you repeat her question? If you have questions.
I'm talking about taxes. If you are an artist that sells like one or two pieces a year or something.
Are you talking about sales tax or sales tax?
No, well, sales tax, but also income tax.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know the exact numbers, but there's certain amounts that anyone can sell as an individual up to a certain amount per year, and then if you go over that, the amount of tax you have to pay varies. I don't know the numbers for that, but then if you get incorporated or become a business, the benefit of that is that you get more tax breaks. But again, you know, it's just those are the basic things that I know about it. I don't have like specific information about that. But then you could, like your jewelry, like you sell your jewelry, right? So, but I think it's got to be at least like 5 or 10K. Okay, so, and then I wanted to share this diagram. Can you guys read this?
It's pretty tiny, right?
It's the light.
Yeah.
Again, it'll be in the, I'll share this presentation and I'll email it out to the entire group so you can look at it, you know, at home. This was the best diagram I could find on the internet without just creating my own. But basically, just to get an understanding of how the art world is broken up, it's three major sections. You have what they call the individual actors, is the artists, art collectors, patrons, art professionals, critics, and curators. So talk about individuals, right, in those categories. That's one sector. Then you have the art market, okay? That's galleries, art fairs, and auction houses. That's the whole for-profit section of the art world. The third section is institutions and organizations. Those are museums, foundations, artist estates, nonprofit organizations, art events, art prizes, publishers and periodicals, art education, and artist residencies. So these are all the nonprofit sectors. So all three of these sections comprise the art world and interact depending on what's happening. But I thought it was an important piece of information to share because to distinguish the difference between the market and the nonprofit sector. What happens and how things happen in the for-profit sector are very different than how things happen in the nonprofit sector. But so that's another topic. But it's a good diagram. This is a list of a very, very short list of resources for you guys. The last link is the Jerry Salz video that we just watched. And it'll take you to that page, My Five Things. And it's got a lot of written information about Jerry and then even the things that he's talked about. This is actually subscription-based. And so what he was doing was promoting this longer video, which I think is like an hour and a half, 2 hours long. And you pay for it and you can watch. You can get really, really in-depth about all the topics that you just talked about. A couple links I wanted to share was so art and cake. Are any of you familiar with Art and Cake? This is a local organization that they're really pro artists. This is a great resource, great local. It's a website, so it's global, but it's founded by Christine Schumacher. Was a local artist, curator, organizer. But there is a ton of information on Art and Cake. Exhibitions. This one is Los Angeles Artist Collectives, you should check out. So these are local places that have calls for submissions. These are galleries, these are nonprofits. A lot of them I recognize, some of them I have never heard of, but I highly recommend checking that out. Check out the Art and Cake, check out this thing. Now this is where you're going to the last part of today's presentation about Instagram. So, let's see. I wanted to show you guys, I just saw this morning. Ann Weber is a local sculptor. She has a studio in Angels Gate. But she just
created so many opportunities for me, and the most important thing is being able to engage with people all over the world. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hello everyone, I just want to thank you so much for helping me reach 100,000 followers. Never in my wildest dreams did I think that would happen. It has created so many opportunities for me, and the most important thing is being able to engage with people all over the world. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
What's her name again?
But you know, I mean, she's not 20 years old, and she's doing it, and you know, she's found her way. If you read her post, it says, you know, that she posts twice a week. She experimented with different types of posting, whether photos or videos. You know, there's lots of different ways, but 100,000 followers. 100 times more than what I've got. Okay, so this is the final part. So we're just going to do this by, we're going to see who here has Instagram. Okay, great. And who does, the rest of you who don't. And this is totally voluntary. So we want to pair people up. People who don't have Instagram and what people who do. And then you can either just show that person how to navigate it or help them set up an account. Does that sound good? Sound okay? Doesn't have Instagram. I'll show a couple people.